What a great turnout. What a great event. My name is Kevin Greiner. I am the chair of the Georgia Partnership for Excellence in Education. I also serve as the president and CEO of Gas South. And I am very pleased to welcome you all to this great forum. We have actually a record turnout today, which is terrific. It shows the interest in our topic, mental well-being and emotional well-being, and the health well-being, of course, of children in our public schools. I want to thank AT&T for sponsoring the 2016 Critical Issues Forum. Rich Johnson, he's the Director of External Affairs for AT&T. Rich, are you here in the auditorium? If you could stand and be recognized. Thank you, Rich. You know, and I also want to thank Georgia Pacific for hosting the forum. Georgia Pacific has been hosting these on a regular basis for a number of years since I've been involved on the board of the Georgia Partnership for Excellence in Education. I'd like to bring up to the podium now J. Catherine Ross. She is the Senior Director of Community Affairs at Georgia Pacific. J. Catherine and I have had the pleasure of working with each other on a number of community initiatives, and she's going to provide the welcome from the company this morning. J. Catherine.
Good morning. As Kevin said, I'm J. Catherine Ross with Georgia Pacific in Community Affairs, and you may know Georgia Pacific from our brands, from the products that you buy every day, we do hope, such as Dixie Plates and Napkins, Brawny Towels, Angel Soft, and Quilted Northern. That was my shameless plug. That's what the price of being here today. But those of you who know us best know us for our philanthropic giving in the community, especially around education. So this is nothing new for us. We have four main pillars, education being very key, but also entrepreneurship, environment, and community enrichment. But as I reviewed today's agenda, I couldn't help but noticing the education powerhouses that are in this room today. And so I also understand, as Kevin mentioned, that this is one of the largest turnouts in the history of Critical Issues Forum. So clearly this is a topic that we're all passionate and interested in and wanting to make some real change around. I applaud you for being here to exchange knowledge, but more importantly, to drive change. And with one of the highest likelihoods of kids born into poverty, staying in poverty, we really must find and implement sustainable solutions for all of our communities, but especially those that are in disadvantaged communities. So it's my privilege to welcome you here to Georgia Pacific this morning. With this lineup of panelists, I know that you're going to leave with both new knowledge and actions that you can take as a result of gaining that knowledge. So thank you so much for taking the time to invest your time, your talent, to be here, to gain this knowledge, to take steps when you leave here, to really enable Atlanta to continue to thrive. Thank you, and have a great morning here.
Thanks, J. Catherine. And again, thanks to Georgia Pacific for being such a great corporate citizen hosting these events. Let's give them a round of applause as well. All right, so several recent studies, and you'll be hearing a lot about this today, have validated the strong ties that a child's health and well-being have to their academic performance. And just a couple of statistics that I wanted to review with you all is, according to recent kids count data, Georgia ranks 37th among states in children's health. And a simple glance at the report emphasizes that health is more than just a matter of making sure a child gets good nutrition and increased physical activity. And if we're focused on providing all the supports, okay, that are needed to help kids succeed in school, it takes paying attention to mental and behavioral health as well. So it's really three key issues, mental, behavioral, as well as that physical health, that are all very important. And nearly 80% of the kids in Georgia who need behavioral health services don't get them today. So we've got a big gap and a big opportunity to address here. Now, schools have become a focal point, of course, in the movement to improve child health and wellness, but they can't act alone, and that's what today's program is about. What are the various support structures, the various entities that need to work together, collaborate, and create that community impact that is so important for the well-being of our kids? Also, as we begin today's discussion, we want to announce that May 5th is Children's Mental Health Day. I think you're going to be hearing a little bit more about that from Emily Pelton, Voices of Georgia's Children. There will be, I would actually encourage folks to take a quick visit to Voices for Georgia's Children's website. It gives you a few simple tips on how you can support opening up the conversation to get kids more of the services that they need. I also want to give a plug to the Georgia Partnership for Excellence in Education. You know, I've had the privilege of heading the board for about the last year or so. It is such a great organization. I'm so proud to be associated with it. For those of you that aren't as familiar with GPEE, we are the leading research, policy, and advocacy organization focusing on issues of education in the state. And what I love about GPEE is the board is really unique. It's comprised of education leaders, business leaders, and political leaders, and governmental leaders, who are all working together and having great conversations around what is the best path for us to take in Georgia to enhance the value of our education. It goes from early childhood education right through to primary, secondary, and in fact, higher education as well. It's a great organization. I urge you to visit our website, learn more about the organization, and also there's an envelope in your packets that you'll see. We can't do the work without raising money from our supporters, and we'd love for you all to be supporters and to contribute whatever you can to the work of GPEE so that we can continue to fund these types of programs and the types of research that we do. So without further ado, I'm going to call on Steve Dollinger. He is our president, does a great job running the organization along with the rest of the GPEE staff. They're really a fantastic team. And Steve is going to deliver the president's report. Thank you very much, and I hope you enjoy your day today. Thank you.
Thank you, Kevin. Kevin's exactly on point. We do have a very strong board. It starts at the top with his leadership. But that's part of what helps us keep our focus and help us do our good work. But good morning. It is exciting to have our largest registration ever for one of our critical issue forums. We were near 200. Typically, 120, 125 would be our average. Of course, there's some people who forget to register and come in, some people who have conflicts and can't come on this day. But for your friends and colleagues who were not able to be here, please remind them that this is being videotaped. It'll be on our website first of next week, so you can go back to pick up some pieces if you need it, and or encourage your colleagues to go there and observe also. Let me run down what's in your packet real quickly so you can understand why we put some of those things in there. With the agenda, I'll come back to that in just a minute to go over that piece. The yellow buff pages are the bios of our speakers and panel members. You can read this. Do away with extensive introductions as we go through the program. We'll give you the names and the faces to go together, but we won't go through all the bios, so you can see that. We do a lot of our work in research, convening, communications, and advocacy. That communications part, Bill Maddox, our communication director, is really strong, and it's a lot of his hard work. He tees us up as staff members to have interviews frequently with reporters, radio, TV, newspapers. You can see here in the electronic newsletter, Maria Saporta's report, an article there that Dr. Dana Rickman did. Right behind that is another one of her articles, a James Magazine. Just about every publication invites us to put an article in there about one of the critical issues. Sometimes we'll rotate among staff. We've had our chair, Kevin Greiner, do a piece there, but it gives us a chance to tell the business community, the readers of James Magazine, a little bit more information about some of these critical issues. Behind that is a sheet for you to sign up if you're not on our distribution list to get these articles, announcements of these kinds of meetings, and you'd like to have more access to our information, please sign up and leave this on your way out. And those of you who like to do a little tweeting during the meeting, you can see down there, use hashtag GPEEF Forum and just tweet to your heart's delight. The green sheet behind that are a list of attendees. This was as of yesterday morning when we started making copies. As I mentioned, there were some others who signed up and some others who walked in. But you can see, as Kevin said, similar to our board, our meetings are open to all the community members. So we get a good cross-section of business, government, education, and community leaders. And If there's anyone you need to network with, maybe you can snag them on the way out. All right, back up to the agenda. It's interesting for me that over the last year, almost 2 years, we've had a lot of urging, a lot of pushing on us to do more work in this child well-being space. If you're familiar with our work, we typically talk about the birth to work pipeline, and we talk about programs and strategies that would support that birth to work pipeline with the goal of having more kids graduating from high school than they would be college and career ready. You've heard a lot of that conversation. Intellectually, we know how important child health, mental and physical health, their well-being is to the success of that pipeline. But all too often, I think that goes unnoticed. So part of what we got into with this is to think about the data pieces. Bobby Cagle, who used to be on our board when he was with DECAL, and I were talking over a year ago and talking about what we might do with this topic. And Bobby mentioned to me, he said, "Steve, I know you like the data." He said, "Get this." He said, "Do you know that the graduation rate of students in foster care is 15%? I had the same reaction. We talk about our state's now around 79%, so that's pretty low. So we have other information. Kevin just mentioned that 80% of the kids who are diagnosed with some kind of a mental health issue go unserved. About 1 in 5 of our kids age 0 to 18 have some kind of diagnosable mental health issue. So it's a whole lot of kids are not being served. So when we talk about that birth to work pipeline, we realize that there's some issues there that we need to address. A way we address that is not just through our communications, but it's also through our advocacy and our collaborations. One of the strong pieces we have there is our group of education policy fellows. We're just wrapping up the class of this year, and this is our 7th class. Would the members of the current class and our alum of Education Policy Fellows please stand? Let's give them a round of applause. It's interesting to me, as I go to different convenings across the metro area and across the state, I see more and more of our policy fellows who are there, who are engaged. We challenge them with the, so what? You're gonna be in this class for a year, you're gonna network with, again, business, government, education, community leaders, foundation leaders. So what are you gonna do with that kind of information, that knowledge you've gained? We've had some that go on for a post-secondary degree, we've had some run for school board, some for state representative, but that class gets really involved back in their communities. Out on the table are the applications for this upcoming class, which will start next fall. We'll be reviewing those, so if you would like to be an applicant, we would love to get an increased pool. We usually have about 20 or 22 people in that class. They just came back from their annual trip when the other 15 or 16 states that have policy fellows come together in DC and just enhance that networking opportunity. But back to today. So, kind of the so what for us, what do we do with the need to address this topic more deeply? So we thought we would use our convening strategy and dedicate one of our critical issue forums to this topic of well-being. As we were looking around and getting more of our information together, we were impressed with the final report of the House Study Committee on Child's Mental Health. There are copies of this out on the table also. If you didn't pick one up, I would suggest you look at this, and it gives you that broad picture. We thought that's a good way for us to start off this meeting, is to give you that broad picture so we all have kind of a floor of what's going on, what has been going on, and maybe what should be going on. And to do that, we have one of the committee members, Representative Rick Jasperse from the 11th District, that's down in South Georgia. He was kind enough to join us this morning to give you a little bit of that overall picture of child mental health in Georgia. Honorable Mr. Jasperse.
Well, I'm glad to be here today and got Crocs on because I've got gout. If any of y'all ever had that, it really, it's a rough deal. But, you know, but I'm glad to be here talking about a subject that's obviously very important. You can look at our attendance today to see how important it is to you. And as a member of the committee, the four of us that listened to this last fall, you could see the passion and interest that people had in this subject, and it's really heartening, but also I'll tell you in a minute other parts about it. Now, actually, I live in North Georgia, and I live up in Jasper. It's an hour and a half or 3 hours from here, depending on what time you leave. And I don't have to tell any of y'all that, I'm sure. I've been in the General Assembly since 2010. I'm a retired county agricultural agent, and I tell you that because, you know, when I give you an ending, it's going to be important. What I did was an ag agent. If you listen to Walter Reeves on WSB, I was the plant guy, the cow guy. But more importantly, I was the 4-H guy. And 4-H is a youth program that's run by the University of Georgia. And it's youth leadership. You get kids from all different backgrounds and economic levels. And it's where I really became involved in children's issues and something that I've always held close. And that's why I'm here today, because Katie Dempsey knows that. My wife is a first grade teacher. I have a daughter who's a high school English teacher who is very much howling about testing this week. And we had the longest discussion about this subject this morning on my drive in, and you know what an impact it makes in her high school kids and what goes on there. And so it's been real enlightening for me to do that. You know, being a county agent in a community, you really get a great view of what goes on in the county because you're a problem solver. You're always trying to figure out how to help people. And that served me well in the General Assembly, but it really gave me a good snapshot, or really of a lifetime, of what goes on in the communities, the good, the bad, and sometimes I just say the successes in a community are just the absolute failures. And I think this is what we're seeing in some of this. You know, study committees are very important in the General Assembly. I'm the chairman of the committee that filters all the study committees. And this past session, we had 40 requests for study committees. And if you think about that, you think, man, we've got a lot of problems that need to be solving, because that's what study committees are for. It gives the legislature an opportunity to bring people like you in and tell us the issues. But the 40 we had this year ranged from the issues with craft breweries to behavioral health issues and agricultural tax issues. So we had to kind of narrow those down. And out of those 40, we only funded 11. So I had to tell how many of that 29 people know. So I get people crying in my office and calling me ugly words and things like that. But we had to kind of limit what we study. But chairmen of committees can also study things on their own. I know Chairman Dempsey's done that. But we do have a lot of issues in Georgia, and this is one that has really been important to us. When we look at House Resolution 641, and that's what this was created just to study an issue Chairman Dempsey thought was real important. You know, Chairman Dempsey's been a champion of this issue. I know that y'all know that. And to have a successful study committee, she's got to find people that are going to help her. And so she looked around the General Assembly and she picked Randy Nix, a retired educator, Joyce Chandler, who's a retired school counselor, Ms. Pat Gardner, who's always great with social issues, and me, kind of an unlikely group, including me in there, to help her. We met 4 times. And I have to tell you, after the first meeting, I was sitting up there in the front, if you've ever been to a committee meeting at the Capitol, and I just sat there and I just put my head in my hands, I'll be honest, and just went, my gosh, I didn't know what was going on in this facet of what y'all toil and work very hard in every day. And I think that was generally, I think Ms. Gardner knew about it, and Katie knew about it, and Randy knew about it, but I didn't, because I'm not in schools every day and dealing with kids, especially now in this world. It really made an impression on me. You know, we had 3 things that we did to do, that we really said in our report, but the most important one is not listed there, and that one was to listen. And I think in study committees, if you do one thing and one thing well, is you listen and you get out across the state. I served on an education study committee 2 years ago. We had 11 meetings across the state. One of those meetings lasted 16 hours because there were so many people who wanted to speak. And so we sat there and we listened. It was the longest meeting I've ever been in my life. But But that was the idea, though. And I want to get you to make sure you understand that that's what we do is we listen. You know, when we're at the Capitol, it's hard to. In January, February, March, it's hard to listen. But during September, October, November, it's easy to. And I think we really try to. You know, the other things we wanted to was examine early intervention and prevention services, you know, what's going on out there, identify vital resources for children with mental health issues, and evaluate possible improvements in the delivery of those services. The meetings were all well attended. I have to tell you, I was, and a lot of you were there. Of course, the usual suspects all spoke and gave us their opinions, what needed to be done. Chairman Dempsey really made sure everybody had a chance to speak, and I think that's just one thing that she's great about. You know, one thing that I was very saddened about, you know, that was after that first meeting when I heard the quote you just made that 20% of all of our children have a diagnosable mental health problem. That sticks with me. I was speaking to a group of kids Tuesday night. So this is the life of a legislator. At 7 o'clock, I spoke to the Tea Party in Jasper. At 7:40, I spoke to the youth leadership graduation. And so it was in the same building, so I walked halls, but I did have to shake my head and get my thoughts around a whole different world of people and what we were doing, but it was just interesting. But that, I was standing, sitting in that room waiting to speak, thinking about that 20%, you know, how many of those kids that were in the room that I was fixing to talk to be in that group. Because we know that it really affects, you know, everything about them, their education, their social, their just their emotional development, in the end, their economic development, you know, how they end up integrating into our society and what they can do. It's an issue that we recognize that many of you work on and toil on day in and day out, under the radar, nobody knows about it, and I think you've got a great advocate, Commissioner Cagle, that's out there talking about the issue all across the state, and all the other commissioners and all the different ones, but I hope you know that the legislature, most of us know what you're up to, and we appreciate it. During our committee meetings, one issue that really hit upon us, I think, for me, as I was looking back on my notes, is the shortage of people who are trained to do these jobs. And, you know, the low graduation rates of psychiatrists, child psychiatrists, the high per capita ratios that provide treatment, it's something that needs to work on. It really concerns us all because, you know, if they're not there to treat them, they don't get the treatment. It hits that 80% that you talked about a moment ago. In the report, I hope you pick up a copy, and if you don't get one, you can certainly get hold of me or Chairman Dempsey, and we'll get you one. Was the number of counties without a licensed psychologist or a licensed social worker or even either one of them? And the illustrated map that's in there kind of shows it to you, and you kind of, boy, it really makes you think, because those are giant gaps in the care that we see. And based on what we heard, we made 16 different recommendations, and I'm just going to go over a couple of them. But I think the key one we saw that had needed to be done the most was developing a strategic plan on children's mental health to provide comprehensive, accessible, and coordinated mental health prevention, and timely interventions and appropriate treatment for children. Felt that this one was a very important one because it didn't require a lot of extra funds because it's already being done, a lot of it, but we just needed the coordination. The committee also felt that an annual recommendation for the state budget riders be created. You know, there's an advisory committee that would go along with that strategic plan, and they would show what needs to be done. And I think I'm on the K-12 Appropriations Committee, and we go by that stuff. We have to know. And I think those of us who are on this, you know, small group of people that looks at the giant part of the budget relies on what we hear throughout the state to do anything with it. One thing that I thought of when we were sitting there in one of the meetings just discussing it was, you know, we have created loan forgiveness programs in a number of different high demand, high need issues across our state. Surely seems like there's room for one to be created for those studying psychiatry or psychology and commit to work with our youth for 3, 4, 5 years. I think that's one thing we need to look at. You know, developing clearinghouse for information that people can use, expanding PBIS in our schools, especially in our early childhood pre-K areas. You know, that was important in our K-12 budget writing process this year. On the House side, we added $250,000 and it doesn't sound like a lot, but in that, when you're moving money around, it gets to be a lot, to improve PBIS throughout schools in the state. That'd be going through the Reeses. And also, the last one we have in there was 16. And it's to get people to work together. You know, I've worked for a state agency for a long time as a county agent. I know we each have our silos and things we want to do. But, you know, in limited resources and giant problems, you have to almost work together to find solutions for those things. And we felt that, and we listed number 16, one of the recommendations we had. But that's just a few, but I want to talk about something a little bit more important, too. Just take a moment for my soapbox moment. You know, when we're in the legislative session through January, February, and March, it is crazy town. And people like me who are chairmen of committees, you know, we've got meetings to go to, I'm on six different committees, and always have lots of different bills going on. Your time to educate me is not January, February, and March. On the rope line, when there are 477 people out there hollering at people. It's in September, October, November, and December. And you know, most of y'all are metro folks. You know, there's 180 of us across the state just in the House. But you have partners throughout the state. They need to take time and talk to people like me. I'm in a rural, it's kind of suburban, rural area in North Georgia. But throughout the state, and make sure they understand the issues. I think this is one of those issues people kind of get a little queasy about talking about to legislators, maybe. You know, no one's ever talked to me about it except in the study committee. But I've learned what I know through the study committee, but there's a lot of legislators that really need to understand it. And just because the gentleman might be the chairman of the Regulated Industries Committee, he's going to vote on a bill that's going to affect this. He's going to vote on the budget process. And they need, you're just this whole world of knowledge, and this needs to increase. But you can't wait until January, February, or March. You know, the budget's written, everything's done. We're all just trying to get to day 40, just as quick as we can to get done. But that's one thing I just wanted to make sure you did and worked on, was building relationships with people like me and other committee members and other, you know, House and Senate members, so they know your issues. But I thank you for allowing me the opportunity to speak with you today and this morning, maybe get some conversation going for our panel that gets there. Chairman Dempsey wanted me to make sure I said to please call her. I know y'all appreciate her and you work with her very closely, and she loves this issue and just dedicated her life to it. And I just appreciate getting to be here and stand in for her. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Jasperse. Excellent job of teeing this up for us. So now you've heard of some of the challenges that the House Study Committee uncovered, some of the recommendations that they gave. As we go into the panel now, begin thinking about what we always want to talk about, so what? What can you or your organization do to help this? A big part of the conversation has been a need for strategic planning to reduce the fragmentation. In fact, as you look through that report, you'll see the number of agencies that are involved in this arena. In fact, that was a challenge for us to have our panel today. With that, would the panel members please come on up? We could have had a dozen people on the stage to represent all the different voices. We tried to get a group of panel members that could represent some of the big areas and it could talk about other areas. And we've asked them to have a conversation. Not just to throw out a question and answer, but for them to talk about what each other is doing. Before I introduce them, I want to make one other introduction to you while we have a good crowd, and that is that we've hired an additional person for our team, and that is Caitlin Darty. Caitlin, would you please stand up? Everybody see you. Welcome, Caitlin, please, to the partnership. That brings our huge staff to 7. But we do some really fun and interesting work and heavy lifting. Caitlin's going to be focused on our blueprint education policy work, which is really like a gap analysis of education policy. What does Georgia have compared to some other high-performance states, or what we do not have that we should have in place? That's going to keep her busy for quite a while. Okay, now to let you know the names and faces, we'll start here. And you've got the bios again in your packet. Commissioner Bobby Cagle, Executive Director Emily Pelton, Deputy Superintendent Gary McGibney, and our moderator, Kim Anderson. Kim, it's for you.
Good morning. So we're going to have a conversation for a few minutes, and then we're going to take some questions from you all. So we're going to try to set a framework for us to discuss child well-being and the importance of it to education. And as Steve talked about, historically, the partnership has focused on how do we ensure children are ready for the workplace. But before children can be ready for the workplace, they have to be ready for education. They have to be ready to be educated. They have to be physically and mentally and emotionally ready to receive what we have and choose to impart upon them through our educational system. And in preparation for today, I came across a quote from an Indian philosopher that I thought was appropriate. It says, "Health is a state of complete harmony of the body, mind, and spirit. When one is free from physical disability and mental distractions, the gates of the soul open." And so we believe that if we ensure that a child's mind and body and soul is ready for education, the gates of the world will open up for them. So we want to talk about that a little bit today. So I'm going to start with a question for each one of our panelists, which will sort of set a stage for them to talk for a few minutes about how they see child well-being and how it impacts education. So we'll start with Emily. And Emily, as was mentioned earlier, Georgia struggles. Many of us talk about always opening up the list and seeing us at the bottom. We're always at the bottom. And as noted earlier, pursuant to the Kids Count data, we rank 37th among all the states as it relates to health indicators. And we rank last or next to last as it relates to access to mental health services for children. So when we delve deeper into child well-being, and particularly the issue of health, where do you see the biggest opportunities? Where do you see where we have the opportunity to improve and make improvements toward a child's health and well-being?
Thank you, Kim. Can you all hear me? Okay. First of all, I love the mind, body, and soul idea, because I think that integrated idea of children as people and beings that are not just some part of themselves, a student or an offender or a patient. They're children, and we're trying to educate them. And I really appreciated Representative Jasper's opening remarks, because I think it highlighted what we are doing now, which is having these kind of conversations. This Critical Issues Forum is bringing us all together to think about the ways that health and education and mental health, how all these things impact the brain development of children, and really that's what's at the core of knowledge and going into the workforce eventually. So I'm just so encouraged by the very fact of this event. It's exciting. I think when we look at, well, why aren't we where we want to be, let's look at what does it mean to be 37th. If you look at that Kids Count data, which we do examine closely for health indicators, that you break that down, that's an amalgamation of factors like teen pregnancies, child deaths, infant mortality. There are a lot of things. Actually, where Georgia is getting better and where there are some bright spots and we do see improvement, but there's some places where we're really stuck when we look at that data. And so I think where we need to have this collective conversation is around what are the barriers to access and how can we overcome them. One of them that's really important systemically is insurance access. We have about 200,000 kids in the state who are not insured, even though about two-thirds of them or more are eligible for public assistance. And there's really no reason those kids don't have access. This is not about Medicaid expansion. This is simply about bringing kids into the system as it's structured now. So that's an area where we have some work to do. And we need to see progress in enrollment and also the technology and the interoperability between the agencies that can make that happen. And Representative Jaspers did a great job of setting me up here to talk a little bit just about network adequacy. It doesn't help when we identify needs in kids and we refer them and there's nowhere to send them. And that map in the report is something actually we generated at Voices. Two-thirds of the counties in this state lack any kind of licensed psychologists, and about a third have no mental health professionals at all. And that's something to really sit with and think about what that means. And 63 counties have no pediatrician. So when we're talking about why kids aren't getting what they need, we have to just start with the fact that there aren't professionals there who can provide that. So we need to think about what we can all do to help industries and care management organizations improve that. So what's the collective challenge to us there? A couple of things that are, you know, barriers, but really opportunities for us now are some things that are already in motion. The opportunity to leverage telehealth, especially in underserved areas. There's a lot of equipment, but we don't have the provider model to support that, but there's a lot of work going on around expanding telehealth, and that's one way that we can bridge that gap, as well as school-based health centers, which I hope we'll talk about a little bit more. These are school-based primary care facilities that are getting amazing results both for kids and for health outcomes and for reduced utilization of hospitals. And we just need to think about a strategy to expand that. And finally, just in closing out my bit here, I would just say we have a little bit of a conceptual barrier. And that's the problem, that we keep thinking about how to get kids to work in the systems that we have and optimize their performance, rather than maybe starting at the place of where are the kids and meeting the kids and the families where they are. And that's where approaches like school-based health centers come in, because we see when we serve kids at schools, we have less absenteeism, we have better grades, we have less visits to the hospital, we have kids going back to class after they have an asthma attack, and that really changes the equation. And we also have an incredible network of after-school providers, after-school programs in Georgia that could really be ramped up. That's a great place to meet kids who maybe are vulnerable to summer learning loss or aren't getting everything that they need. And then we have opportunities to really improve preventive mental health, and I'm sure we'll talk about that. But once kids reach the doors of DFACS or the juvenile justice system, those kids are in very high need for mental health services, and their families may have been as well. If we could catch them and help them before they get to those doors, where their prospects of graduation go down, and where the cost of serving those kids skyrockets, if we could just get to them a little earlier, we could really see a different trajectory. So I think those are, you know, some of the big ticket items that if we could really tackle them together, we could be telling a whole different story here in a few years if we came back to this.
Okay. So I'm going to move to Bobby, and I do want to preface Bobby's comments with the fact that he's going to have to leave around 11:15. So we're going to try to get to his point and then Gary's point and get some questions so that he can share with us. So Bobby, we've talked a little bit about effectiveness and efficiencies. And one of the highlights that both Emily and the representative brought up is the fact that on the private sector side, we don't have enough providers. We have a rate of one mental health provider to 1,600 individuals in the state of Georgia compared to states that have 1 to 300. Now, but on the public sector side, the report seems to indicate that we have a lot of players, or at least there's the opportunity of coordination. We have the Department of Behavioral Health and Developmental Disabilities, the Department of Juvenile Justice, and as well as DHS and DFACS and others under DHS, all involved in programs providing services to children that have some degree of health involvement, particularly in behavioral health. So the report seems to allude that there's some fragmentation of services, particularly on the public health side. What do you see as the opportunities and challenges as it relates to public health fragmentation and how we can coordinate services and opportunities?
Thank you, Kim. And I think to give you a better idea of what we're talking about, I should probably just touch on the population that we deal with. So at this point in time, we're operating in about 36,000 families in the state of Georgia with some sort of investigation, ongoing service where we found abuse or neglect in families, or we have taken children into foster care. Currently, we have about 13,000 children in foster care in the state of Georgia. I have legal custody of those kids, and so as such, we're responsible, as parents would be, for all of the things that those kids need, including the mental health, the behavioral health, dental health, and the educational outcomes for those kids. What we see is a great deal of difficulty from our staff's perspective. If you think about the amount of time that you spend as a parent in doing those things for your own child, think about the amount of time that it takes our foster parents and our caseworkers to do that for the children on their caseloads. Typically, we think that caseworkers ought to carry about 15 cases, 15 children. And if you look at our caseloads right now, you have a range across the state from anywhere from 15 children up to 30 to 35 children. And if you do the math quickly on how much time that takes, just think about 30 times what you do with one child. And so part of the difficulty here is having staff that have enough time to get the work done. Unfortunately, we've been in dire straits for a number of years, and I think that's no surprise to anybody. What we had when I came aboard in 2014 was about 1,650 case managers. We needed about 2,700 in order to be able to do the work efficiently. So the collaboration across agencies suffers when that is a circumstance. I think that has improved. We've gotten about 628 staff over the last three budget cycles, so we're moving closer to where we need to be, but we're still at a deficit when it comes to having enough caseworkers to do the work on behalf of the children that we serve. And these are children that have great needs. These are kids who've suffered trauma of having those people who ought to be the ones that love and care for them the most actually inflict injury on them, either emotional or physical. And those kids, when they come into our care, approximately 80% of them have mental or behavioral health needs. The vast majority of them have physical health needs that have not been attended to. And so we're playing catch up. We also see that not every system is as understanding of the plight of foster children as they need to be. School systems in particular, and I take the responsibility for this because I don't think we have reached out historically to our schools to help them understand the needs of foster children. So when a foster child goes into a school system, what is seen is a child with behavior issues, when in fact this is a child that's a victim that has been traumatized multiple times. And the behavior, as a professor of mine told me in college, there are normal reactions to normal circumstances, there are abnormal reactions to abnormal circumstances, and then there are normal reactions to abnormal circumstances. So these kids, although they appear to have behavior problems, probably are acting out in ways that really make sense because of the trauma that they've suffered. What happens as a result of that, however, is oftentimes those kids are sent to tribunals for behavior issues, and they are there by themselves with nobody to represent them because our caseworkers can't get to those meetings oftentimes, and they end up going through another traumatic experience being expelled from school. What is really needed here is truly some additional collaboration, additional work across agencies. But I think you cannot in any way undersell or should not undersell the importance of the lack of private providers, because we depend greatly on private providers to serve these kids. The private provider networks vary. I see some folks from AmeriGroup here with us today, who is the care management organization that serves our kids. Oftentimes we talk about access as being the be-all end-all for healthcare, when in fact we have access for all of our kids. It's a matter of coordination and getting those kids to those appointments. But then we also have areas of the state where AmeriGroup is trying very hard to get additional providers, but we have things that were described earlier. So what I would say is that this is a very special group of children in the state, a group of children that really need more consideration than what we've given them in the past. The mental health issues that come along with the kind of experience that these children have had really begs for us to handle them in a different, more tender way than what we have in the past, because otherwise we're inflicting further injury to children who've already been injured.
Thank you. So Bobby spoke a little bit about collaboration, particularly for children who've experienced extraordinary trauma. And many of us know, and for a long time, schools have been involved in the health of children. And many of us are old enough to remember nurses in schools. Talk to us a little bit, Gary, about some bold things that the school system's doing to provide holistic services to children, particularly both for mental health and physical health. And I know you and I spoke earlier about PBIS. Maybe you might want to share a little bit about what PBIS is, or how it's working, where is it being successful, and where you're seeing challenges and opportunities.
Okay, thank you, Kim. Hello, everyone. Good morning. Before I start into that, I would like to throw a few more statistics at you because I think they're important. 44% represented Jasperse of children with mental health issues drop out of school. But one piece of data that you probably don't hear is that children with mental health issues miss anywhere from 18 to 30 days of school each year, every year, not just in the first grade or the fifth grade, but it's typically ongoing if they do not receive intervention. And also something that may surprise you, and the correlation is still being studied, is a national study showed that 75% of children with mental health issues have literacy deficiencies. They don't read. If they don't read, what's the likelihood of them graduating from high school? And if you don't graduate from high school, we know that's a quality of life issue. It's also a physical health issue as well as a mental health issue. So there's a lot involved in this, Kim, that's not just services to children with mental health issues. So at the DOE, we're trying a number of things. Not enough, and there's not enough collaboration, and we all will have to work on that, Bobby and Emily and Kim. But we do have the PBIS, was Positive Behavior Intervention and Supports. Representative Jasper has referred to that in his comments, and that was part of the recommendation of the report. PBIS, I don't know if you've heard about that. It's not a project, it's not a program, it's not a strategy, it's a framework to help a school rethink how they approach discipline in the school. It's a framework for improving school climate. It's not a panacea. It's not a M&M rewards operant conditioning program. It's really a process where the entire staff sits down and looks at data. They look at their discipline data. They look at their attendance data. They look at data from the Georgia Student Health Survey. How many of you are familiar with that? Some. We give that to every year anonymously to students who take it online. And over 1 million students take that survey. But they can look at that data because it goes all the way down to the school and all the way even down, and you can look at it individually as far as groups of students and levels of students, and the school can look at that data and see what the students are telling the school administrators. But also we have a parent survey and a staff survey. So that's additional data they can look at. So they go through a process, they being the entire staff, we're talking about certified and non-certified staff, bus drivers, custodians, everyone who's in that building. And they look at the data. We give them a framework of how to do that. Typically, and we're moving more toward looking at it like an epidemiologist, looking for cause and effect and trends. And the staff then identifies what are the problems that are unique to that school. And then from that, they develop a strategy to improve the school climate that's unique for that school. So you may have 10 schools in the same school district, and they will have 10, most likely will have 10 different types of PBS framework for that particular school. And they implement it in different stages. We offer the training for free. We encourage it to be it has to be supported at the leadership level. If the superintendent of a school district doesn't support it, then we don't offer it. You know why, don't you? There has to be sustainability. There has to be sustainability. And what we have found is in some school districts, they are reluctant to implement PBIS. We will look for data and suggest to a school system they have issues they may want to address, but we don't make them do PBS. That's counterproductive. But some of them will say, okay, Gary, we'll pilot in a school or two. We had one of the largest school systems in Georgia was very reluctant about PBS, even though we pointed out some data. And they said, okay, we'll pilot it, Gary, okay, we'll pilot it in 10 schools. They're now up to 70 schools because it worked. And when I say it worked, this is what I mean. The climate of the school improves. Teacher retention increases. Student attendance increases. The number of referrals to the discipline office or for discipline reasons goes down. The number of out-of-school suspensions go down. Now, the reason I mention office discipline referrals is that's really important in elementary school because typically you don't have a lot of suspensions in elementary school. So what is your measure? Look at office discipline referrals. That's the key component. And even we're finding out in middle school and high school, that's a key component too, because that's where it starts. Oftentimes, the first discipline referral doesn't lead to a suspension, but if you start seeing an increase in number of office discipline referrals, guess what will go up eventually? But also we have, I don't want to just start with PBS if I have just a moment further, we have a federal grant for Project Aware, which is mental health awareness training using a lot of training around the youth mental health first aid training module. And what we're finding from staff in schools is they have no idea, I mean really no idea what to look for with students who have mental health issues. They could not discern between defiant behavior and symptomatic behavior. Now folks, think about that for a second, the difference between defiant behavior and symptomatic behavior. What is your reaction going to be to that? You all remember your classes in attribution theory where we respond more to why we think somebody did something than what they actually did. If you think it's defiant behavior as opposed to symptomatic behavior, what is your reaction going to be? Send them to a tribunal, Bobby. But if it's symptomatic behavior, what's your reaction going to be? You know, I think maybe Gary needs to go to the counselor. That's a major difference in the climate that a school has. And if I have time, I would like to give you an example and personalize that by giving an example of a student that I know, not a composite student, but a young student named Melissa. But I want to be cognizant of everybody else's time, so you let me know when that's appropriate.
Okay, great. Okay, so I appreciate that. And so we've heard some data that some of us are familiar with, and some of us, it should hurt all of our hearts, right, to know that this is the situation in Georgia. And particularly when we couple that with the child well-being data, with the educational outcomes data, it should call us all to action, which is, I'm sure, why you all are here. And we also heard some solutions, each one of you touched, but let's talk a little bit more about solutions, because we're all here because we want to move the ball forward. So, think about and like you to share your greatest wishes, particularly if you thought about local and state collaboration on both a policy level and on a practice level. And as you come up with your solutions that you want to share and for us to discuss, let's also keep in mind the issue of inequity, particularly in Georgia, in Metro Atlanta, we have the dubious distinction of being the most unequal city in America. And so that presents challenges when we talk about holistic approaches. So we'll start with Commissioner Bobby Cagle, just because I know you have some shortness of time, but share some of your solutions, Bobby.
You know, I think the earlier discussion around collaboration across agencies is extremely important. I think we have existing collaborations in most areas. With DOE, we have collaborations and sharing data that are very, very important. I think the lack of collaboration, however, happens on the local level. We have 181 school districts in the state, and what we really need, my fondest hope and desire, would be to have a true memorandum of understanding and collaborative effort with every school district in the state. The other thing that I'd really like to have is to have a social worker who could act as an advocate in each one of those school districts on behalf of the kids that we serve. I think the other thing is something that we've worked on together with Families First and Georgia CASA, which I think has a lot of potential, which is having advocates who are trained in the education arena be able to be assigned to each one of our children. Because I have to tell you that as a social worker, I sat through many, many planning meetings that I did not understand whatsoever when I was a social worker starting out. And I've signed off on educational plans that sounded great to me. I trusted the people I was in the room with, but frankly, I had no expertise in that area. My social workers are the same way. We're trained in social work, not education. So I think the potential around collaboration with school systems, but also having those who are trained, assigned to our kids to help advocate for what they need in the school systems is going to be extremely important. The overall thing I think that we have to shoot for, however, is an understanding that expulsion of kids with behavioral health issues that have come from very traumatic backgrounds is not the solution. That is really perpetuating the problem. The end result of this, of course, is the 15% graduation rate that we quoted earlier. The factors that go into that, primarily, as I understand it, are attendance, behavior, and the coursework that kids do. That's the graduation three factors. Attendance on our kids' part is very, very low. I heard DJJ yesterday, and I think it's similar for us, say that on average when they get a kid in their custody, 61 days of school have been missed in that school year. And if you don't think that's impossible to pass courses, you ought to try it sometime. But it is really incumbent upon us to work across systems and not to blame one another. Frankly, I want to be really clear that I'm not blaming school systems. I'm blaming us as a system entirely.
Emily?
So I knew I would like what you had to say today. So I couldn't underscore all of that more strongly. I think thinking about this difference that Gary mentioned between differentiating behaviors and understanding why kids are doing what they're doing is so important. We don't need to be expelling four-year-olds. We don't need to be, sending kids into detention situations when really what they need is a caring adult or a psychologist. So I think it's really thinking about how are we treating kids in the systems that we have. I think another, and I'm sitting between two of the most collaborative state government officials that I know who really are seriously working and very personally committed to collaboration, and you see the evidence of that happening just in recent years. It's great. But I think we do still have these structural challenges within state government where we have a lot of the kids who are struggling the most, who are in the juvenile justice system, who are struggling in school, who may be in state care. These are often the same kids. And so who's responsible for their health care? Who's responsible for their counseling? Who's responsible for making sure that things are going right at home? This can be multiple state agencies operating in the same space, and that can leave the child caught between systems or not having a North Star to follow, or an adult who's really the clear caretaker in that child's life. So I think really sitting down and figuring out how the state agencies that want to solve these problems, that have very committed staff and who really believe in solving these problems, how is that going to happen? And I think it goes back to that initial idea of a statewide mental health plan, which has to involve all the players and all the stakeholders, and not just Department of Behavioral Health and Disabilities and DOE and DFACS and the many others, but there are also many, I think Steve mentioned, many stakeholders in this room who are nonprofits, public agencies, advocacy groups, and others who have a seat at this table, and really thinking about how are the systems not working together and what are the policy barriers that are sending kids back in a loop they don't need to be in. And I think really that doesn't have to happen through some complex legislative negotiation. I mean, I think the legislature can say we need this, but those who do this work day in, day out can sit down together and start to solve those problems. And a lot of the solutions are at hand, but they aren't all in the same room with the right leadership. The last thing I would just add on that, and this is sort of a personal point of advocacy coming from our organization, is that we really think that there's an important role for a public-private dialogue in doing this the right way. That even if we bring our best and brightest of state government together, it can't be done by one state agency alone, and it can't be done by the public sector alone, because there are private funders, there are private companies, there are a lot of people outside of the public funded sector who are part of this story and who have to buy into the solution. So we want to see, what we would like to see is a model of putting that together that is a true public-private partnership. The Child Welfare Reform Commission is a great example, of which Bobby and Stephanie Blank are co-chairs, that's worked really well to generate some policy solutions that are now in practice and are moving forward. So we'd love to see that kind of a process where everybody can get together and say, okay, what does this ideal system look like for our kids? And that would be huge. And the ball is already rolling. Thank you to the Child Mental Health Study Committee. So that's within our reach if we decide to do it.
Great. So if tomorrow you were to convene this collaboration, when we talk about collaboration and coalitions, it always takes a leader. It always takes someone to take the first step, and then everybody has to get an invitation. Somebody has to draft the agenda. So who's at the table tomorrow, and how do we move this forward? Because a lot of times we have these conversations, and we don't walk out with a plan. So what's the plan tomorrow? And we'll start with Gary. Because we do. We have these discussions. Everybody says, that felt good. But nobody has a plan for tomorrow. So we're going to talk about the plan for tomorrow. We'll start with Gary and Bobby, and we'll talk about what this table of collaboration
Thank you for putting me on the spot first. And I'm probably going to say something that's kind of controversial, but probably the most significant reform that's taken place in the state of Georgia in the last few years is juvenile justice reform, mm-hmm. criminal justice reform. And who was the convener of that? The governor. Mm-hmm. I think the mental health issues relate and the needs of children along the lines of mental health is just as important. The two largest providers of mental health services for children is going to be corrections and school systems. And then the school system, is that really mental health services? School counselors are trained to identify mental health needs. They're not therapists. One study showed that 32% of the time school nurses spend in school was on mental health issues, school nurses. So I think it's important enough, and I think the issue has risen enough to the consciousness of people that we need a real powerful person to convene the people that need to come together. And I really applaud the committee's recommendations, Representative Jasperse, because that's a blueprint. It has things in there that are working, like PBIS. We don't have to try it. That's working. It has things in there working, like Project Aware. It has things in there working, like in BHDD's Georgia APEX. Those work. We have the data to show that those work. So why shouldn't the state take on those so they're part of a sustainability plan for children's mental health? There are also, if you look in the report, ladies and gentlemen, there are things in the report that don't cost anything. It just requires, Steve, collaboration. And there are elements of that plan, Representative Jasperse, that would require commitment of the state, monetary commitment, like take over Project Aware when the grant cycle runs out. Make Project APEX part of the service delivery. Make PBS available for every school in the state of Georgia. Don't all our students deserve a positive school climate? We insist on it in our businesses and the grocery store and restaurants and church and mosque and synagogue. We insist on having this room being safe and secure, and we expect to be with people that respect us. Why shouldn't our schools have the same expectation of a positive school climate? That's not a goal. I'm tired of goals. That should be an expectation. And in that report, Representative, look at the report, ladies and gentlemen, and you need to share it. Tax incentives to work on the workforce development. Don't you think the state of Georgia can afford that? For psychiatrists to have reimbursement for the money they pay for their education covered by the state of Georgia, for them to stay in Georgia for 3 to 5 years, they would be glad to do that. Other states are doing that. There's no reason that we can't do this. Like Emily said, the people are there, the heart is there, the need is there, the will is there, but to answer your question, I think it's going to have to come from the governor's office. Sure to get quiet all of a sudden.
Well, I certainly would second my boss as being a great convener. I would take it from a little bit different perspective. You know, I think oftentimes we immediately turn to the professionals to compose these committees. And I would really approach it in a different way, because I think I have an understanding from my professional perspective, as does Gary, as does Emily. But the true perspective that we need to come from is the perspective of the families and children that are really suffering through this. And there are great groups like the Georgia Parent Support Network, Sue Smith. If you don't know Sue Smith, you ought to. The woman's phenomenal. We need to come at it from the perspective of the people who suffer from the problem and form the group around them, so that we have the people who really have lived this lead the reform. And that's where I would come from.
Great. So Emily, as the advocate.
Yeah, the provocateur, I guess.
There you go.
Thank you for joining us, Bobby. First of all, I'll say I think it does take the power of the governor to convene something this broad and this complex and have it stick. So certainly the initiative would need to come from the governor. And I don't think the governor is unaware or not thinking about these issues would be my best guess. I do think that, and I also agree with Bobby, that starting from the perspective of the child's needs and the people who are closest to those needs and making sure they have a voice, a meaningful voice in this conversation, is incredibly important and fundamental. I do think that in order to make this successful, though, we also have some highly complex systems that I do not purport to understand well, including our state Medicaid system, including a lot of the complex interactions that happen in the healthcare system that result in whether children actually get care or whether we're able to put sustainable school-based health centers in schools to meet needs. 4 out of 5 kids who actually get mental health services at all, of those many who don't, but of those who do, 4 out of 5 of them get them at school. So we just have to remember school and services at school are a really important part of this equation. And so the people who are the experts and really do understand how to activate Medicaid codes, attract specialists into telehealth networks, really look at how insurance mechanisms are working in this state, those folks also have to be at the table or it won't work. So I think it's a pretty complex task, thinking about how do we convene those experts, how do we convene the advocates and the people who are at the core of the issue, and then how do we make sure that it has the political clout that it will produce results as Criminal Justice Reform Council, Child Welfare Reform Council, these councils convened by the governor in the past have really worked. So I think that's where we are with this, and I think that's where the conversation is going. And we, Voices, and I know many other advocacy organizations stand ready to be supportive in any way that we are asked to be part of that.
So I think we'll look to an email from Voices that will lead us in our conversation with the governor and rally us together sooner than later, I hope. So as we think about, one of the issues that we talked about in the data was access, and particularly children's access to mental health services, and knowing that about 20% of children between birth and 18 years of age need mental health services, but 75 to 80% of these children are not getting the services that they need, particularly in their communities. So in the room, we have providers, we have both nonprofit and private sector providers, we have insurance companies. When you think about particularly partnerships that you mentioned, how can we, given the limited resources we have now, maybe be creative and thoughtful about providing access as we move toward the long term, as we maybe perhaps provide incentives for providers to come to our state, or particularly to go to the 68 counties that don't have providers? What can we do creatively now? What have you heard or seen that might allow us to address this problem in the short term in some way, shape, or form?
That's a good question. And access, I think typically we think of access in a binary way. Either you have it or you don't. I learned a long time ago, not too long ago, but not too far from here, is the Georgia Tech Humanistic Logistics Center. And how many of you are aware of that? But everybody in here, I would guess, in some part of your duties, involves logistics, access, right? You're trying to figure how to get somebody somewhere, or you're trying to figure out how you get somewhere. That's logistics, that's access. Well, Georgia Tech told a group of us, which was part of the Get Georgia Reading campaign, which includes the four pillars, and one of them is access. The other is early language nutrition. And think about that for a second. A child who doesn't develop early language skills, as Judge Peggy Walker, our juvenile judge, said, their behavior becomes their language. So think about that. But one of the other pillars is access, along with school climate and teacher preparation. The thing about access is, in the Georgia Tech Logistics Center vernacular, is there's six different dimensions. You may have access in a community of mental health services, and the community is 90% Hispanic, but none of the therapists speak Spanish. Is that really access? Or you may have access and students can, or children cannot physically get there, but there's access. So I think, and this is not an exercise in academia, I think we need to define what really access means. I think we need to look thoughtfully about the six components of access, so that when we map out a plan of access, an access plan, we take into consideration all those different components of access. We've done resource mapping. How many of you have been involved in resource mapping? We've done that, and we've become pretty good at resource mapping, but then what do we do with it? And here's, in my opinion, the reason why we fall short. We spend a lot of money on resource mapping, and then we're not sure what to do with it, because it, frankly, sometimes it tells us what we already know. But then what do we do with it? Where we fall short is that we don't have a strategic plan to use the access resource mapping to drive. If we had, as Representative Jasper's committee offered, a statewide mental health children's plan, your resource mapping could then be matched with the plan. So your resource mapping would have some meaning to the plan. So anytime you do resource mapping, if you draw it back to a strategic plan, it has more meaning than just doing resource mapping. So I don't think we have been sophisticated enough, Kim, in approaching what we mean by access and then following through on what we find when we do studies of access, so that then we fall short on providing access.
So we're going to go quickly to Emily, but Representative Jasper is going to join us, and we're going to start questions from the audience, because again, this is about information sharing, and I see a lot of informants in the room, and so we wanted to share in both your questions and your thoughts, because again, this is about us collectively having a dialogue and collectively leading to a solution, because it's, again, about our children. So I don't know, Emily, if you want to make a comment on that, and then if you have a question, members of the partnership staff are around with microphones, and we definitely want to hear from you.
I guess my last comment would be that we don't have to reinvent the wheel. There are some great systems and models and structures and even a lot of physical equipment that is out there right now that can help us. We have a lot of telehealth equipment sitting all over the state, but I used to be in the humanitarian sector and I was always frustrated to go into small communities in developing countries and find schools that had been built, but no one thought about making sure there were going to be teachers there to teach the children, and so they were these sort of, you know, vacated structures. And I worry that we are making these kind of investments in equipment that they're sitting there unused, and that's a tragedy. So we need to look at what are the incentives to draw providers in to work through telehealth to serve these many underserved areas that aren't going to have a provider for a while, even if we do the right thing and invest in attracting and retaining more professionals. We need a way to use the systems that are there now. And we have a lot of other programs like Project Aware, like Project Apex. There are a lot of things that have been started in a number of really successful school-based health centers, in part through substantial federal grants and private funds, significant private funds that have been matched to get these successful models up and rolling. But if at some point there's no state investment coming in behind that, we will lose what we have and we will be worse off than we are sitting here today. So that is really a key point that we need to look at what's working, what's there, what investment is already sitting out there for us to just lift up. And I think that will take us a long way and goes back to this point that this is a very thorny problem that doesn't have to have a super expensive solution. And that should be something that we can all have a civil dialogue about, because we're not talking about a huge enormous investment. We're talking about creating sustainability for things that are already positive and proven. So that's, I think some good news.
Great. So we have, I saw this gentleman's hand here first, and I'm sure there's others.
Barry, you mentioned the data to help schools change the climate. I couldn't understand. Were you saying PCS, BS, BS?
PBIS, which is Positive Behavioral Interventions and Support.
PPIS.
PBIS. I'm sorry. And it's also on our website. If you go to the Georgia Department of Education website, www.gadoe.org, okay. On the drop-down menu, you can click on PBIS, and there's a full page of information. And also, we have another webpage on school climate.
Okay, and the other question was the statewide children's health plan. Do we have that? Did you mention
the plan?
Yeah, the statewide. You were mentioning the state representative's comment about the statewide children's health plan.
We have the recommendation from the Children's House Study Committee. That's the plan that's been referenced. Go ahead.
We have a couple more on this side. And when you take the mic, share your name because people may want to follow up.
Hi, Kim. Tammy Workman, Assistant Superintendent of Student Services in APS. So I have quite a bit to say because we have a lot of challenges, and some of you I know, and I know AmeriGroup we just left a meeting with. Hey, how are you? So, you know, it's about funding, it's about access, it's about coordination. Between the agencies and the partners. We have a wonderful health clinic in Atlanta Public Schools. A shout out to the Zeist Foundation. I just saw Atiba. The Whiteford Clinic, and we have two more coming on board, plus another one, which we just left a meeting about. But it seems as if we have to try to piece it together with different partners and different agencies. So if there was some kind of coordination of all the agencies and the partners and the resources out there, it would just be awesome. And schools are ready to engage because we all know there's a huge need all over the country for physical and mental and behavioral health. But there's just a lot going on at schools, and so we just need that coordination of services, and funding is a barrier, the uninsured is a barrier. We had a conversation today, it's ongoing. You know, you need to have those navigators provided at schools to be able to enroll and re-enroll and work side by side with the school registrars and attendance clerks so we know who has insurance, who doesn't have insurance, and then to make sure that those folks do. I want to give a shout out to Commissioner Cagle because he is the kind of person who will come to you. And so I did want to mention that because he has engaged Atlanta Public Schools about that data share agreement, and I think that's huge. I can't imagine any school district across the state of Georgia who doesn't want to have that. So we know who those children are because right now we really don't. And then along with the PBIS, it's so important. We do have PBIS in our schools, but what we're finding is because we have so many different challenges and we have adults who are working with kids who have needs, the kids have needs, the adults who work with kids have needs, that it really needs to go deeper. So I would just encourage you to look at embedded practices, because when you start having different initiatives at schools and across districts, teachers, principals, they become overwhelmed. So it all needs to be coordinated together. So there are a lot of social, emotional health needs at schools. So I would just encourage you to go that step further, looking at restorative practices, social, emotional learning. I could just go on and on and on. So anyway, I am going to give the mic back.
Hey, good morning, panel. Good morning, Tammy. I'm actually going to pick up where you left off, Tammy. Good morning. My name is Greg Clay. I'm a partner with Lanier Consulting Group here in Atlanta. And for those of us catching up with this type of conversation, in the newer term around social emotional learning, specifically with APS, your thoughts around the progressiveness of those types of concepts when it comes to sustainability. I'd love to get your opinion on, you know, for those of us that want to get engaged and still trying to understand what the issues are, when it comes to sustaining the conversation, how do we proceed, or how should the community perceive that in the steps and the financial commitments that the district is taking in that direction?
Sustainability is probably one of the toughest things because as Superintendent or Assistant Superintendent Workman said, that's the key to a coordinated effort, because without a coordinated effort, that's what you don't have is sustainability. And what we have found, interestingly enough, I'm not going to say that we were wise enough to predict it, but we have found when you improve school climate, say through PBIS, you improve school climate, there's a certain dynamic that really takes place and a change takes place. You create a little system of care in that school. So now when a teacher makes a referral to a student who in the past would have been sent out of the classroom or maybe sent to the office, now the teacher is saying, Gary needs help. Sincerely thinks Gary needs help. Well, if there's no help provided for the student, then what is the teacher then to think? Well, we went through this, we improved school climate, we implemented PBS, we think all this is very good. Now we have a concern for children and each other, for that matter, and you're telling me there's no resources available? So the sustainability that you're talking about is imperative, but it goes back to the lack of the coordination that we've heard in the report, because really what the report is saying, without saying it directly, is there is no coordinated effort. There's very little opportunity for sustainability. Sustainability only happens when you have a coordinated effort. So as far as advocacy for what we're talking about today, if I may be so bold, is to advocate for the coordination that we keep hearing people, the representatives talking about, Superintendent Workman talking about, almost begging for a plan of coordination so that we can have that sustainability. We're going to continue to be a state of projects and programs that run for 2 years and the funding runs out and we're looking for another fund, another grant. The project runs out after 3 years and we have all the evidence to show, Kim, that it worked, but there was no sustainability because there was no overarching strategic plan.
So I know we had another hand on this side, and also in response to the questions, or if you want to raise your hand and respond to a comment, appreciate it, particularly on this coordination issue, right? So again, it's the elephant in the room, and we have it, this, other than calling the governor, which Emily's going to get us all to do, in terms of where we begin this coordination effort. I mean, we keep hearing this call for coordination, and this is the question of where we lead. So did I see a hand here, and then back here?
Hi, my name is Danielle Nabinger, and I'm a consultant with the Mara Group. My question to you, we've been talking a lot about the role of schools and but we also, I think, need to look down, keep looking down the pike. And what is your thinking around engaging in early Head Start, Head Start, and engaging them? Because this doesn't just start all of a sudden when a child goes into school. So any thoughts about that?
Well, I'll start. The DOE, we're working very closely with DECAL, the Department of Early Care and Learning, on a number of projects, one of which is the PBIS being scaled so that it fits in the preschool setting. And we have, you know, national data shows that, believe it or not, the preschool expulsion rate is higher than the high school expulsion rate. Yeah, yeah, you heard me right. He did say that. And one of the reasons why is because of the lack of training of the staff on some of what is typical behavior of children those ages. And we have found with just some minimal intervention, some of the basic concepts of PBIS in the preschool programs changes the outcomes and stabilizes the climate for the school preschool. So DECAL has started using that model, that framework in the preschool programs, and including Head Start.
And I would say, Danielle, one thing we have to always remember, that children, as you well know, don't live in isolation, right? So they live in families, they live in communities, and oftentimes that is the source of the trauma that the children are experiencing or emanating in school. So if we don't address what's going on with parents, there was a recent study of families on the West Side that said the number one cause for child absenteeism was mother's depression. Yeah. It was maternal depression that was leading to children not attending school. Yeah.
Can I just jump in on this one as well? So I was going to start to make the point that you just made. So thank you for that question, Danielle. I think if we think about what this, you know, statewide plan might look like, it's really important to raise what you just did, which is the early education piece of that, the infant and toddler piece, and that social emotional development for little children is not taking them to see the doctor or a counselor necessarily. It's really looking at what's going on with their caregivers. And so not only maternal depression, but also substance abuse and other kinds of things that are going on in the home, that really, if we can't only look at children's health, if we are especially looking at that age group, we have to look at what's going on with adults, and we have to view that as an integrated piece of what we're trying to solve. And I know DECAL is working on that, and there are a number of folks, Gears and others, that are really looking at that early education piece and how we can address expulsions. But it's really thinking about the fact that children at a very young age have social-emotional factors that need a lot of care, and that their brain development is so important at that age. It's particularly almost more important because it's so foundational to what comes next and their resilience to withstand any other trauma that might come. So that's a really huge point, and thank you for raising it.
The data about that related to the population of foster care, between 40% and 50% of all kids in foster care in any county are under the age of 6 right now. So just think about that in terms of the population.
And I want to add, I know this budget that Governor's going to sign on Monday you know, there was a grant for the Community Service Board out in Rome to look at and do some work on families. Thank you. You know, taking it just like you said, and you know, kids in trauma and stress, and working on in a family organizational manner, mm-hmm. bringing the families in, working with the families all the way through with, you know, even substance abuse. So, you know, that's one of Chairman Dempsey's pet, you know, she's worked on very hard to get that money in there to see if that can really be a solution to move towards.
Javon Gibson, Community Health Solutions and the Center for Adolescent and Male Development. Thank you for the commentary and the information that's been shared. I think it's been very powerful. But I think we need to be very cautious when we talk about systems integration. There was a quote that says that systems consistently produce the same output than the systems are designed to produce that output. And when we look for advocacy and leadership from the governor's office, I think we negate the fact that some of the greatest systems change happen at the community level. And in actuality, that change occurs when you have a group of committed actors that decide that a system has to change. And so, to your point, Kim, I think if we sit and wait for the governor to move and advocate, we may find ourselves waiting too long. I think the systems that require change now require change to happen at the grassroots level, informed by those people who are most affected by it, yes, to Commissioner Cagle's point. But I think we all have an obligation to have cross-sector collaboration, champions within our own agencies and organizations that are committed to interagency collaboration. If we champion it from our house, in our circles of influence, and then work together collaboratively and have an informed conversation, then others will listen.
My name is Danielle Gray. I'm with the R. Howard Dobbs Jr. Foundation. I had two questions. One, I know that the most recent budget had an increase for the RESAs to provide additional PBIS training support, but is that enough for the DOE to meet the demand? And if not, what is the budget allocation you would need for that? And my second question is with the Every Student Succeeds Act, I understand that there is a new accountability measure that can be non-academic. And is school climate on the Georgia DOE's short list for that accountability measure?
The first question about the funding. We made a decision a few years ago that was a strategic decision. I think it was the right decision. That is, the DOE cannot own PBIS. We can offer the training, but as far as implementation, it needs to be as close as possible to the school. So with Georgia having 16 regional education service agencies, we thought it would be prudent to put a school climate specialist in each of those 16. But we had limited money to do that. The governor stepped forward and put together $500,000 out of his own budget for us to put part-time school climate specialists in all 16 RESAs. In the last 2 years, the General Assembly has added some money, so those are not quite enough money yet for those to be full-time, but we're close. With the trajectory of funding, if that will continue, Representative Jasperse, by this time next year, those school climate specialists would be full-time in the 16 regional service agencies, and they really have made the difference. Some of those schools, I'll give you one quick example, a school system that was in a recent catchment area that had not had any interest in PBS, even though their expulsion suspension rate was very high, started getting some peer pressure from the RESA in the other catchment area because their schools were implementing PBS and seeing improvement in school climate, seeing expulsions going down. A juvenile judge had noted that the referrals to juvenile court had gone down. So because of peer pressure and influence, and what they found out was there really wasn't reluctance to implement PBS. There was fear that they wouldn't be able to do it successfully. So having, that had nothing to do with the DOE, that was all handled locally. But because of the influence of the RESA, that other local school system now is on the road of implementing PBS. Now, the Every Child Succeeds Act, replacing No Child Left Behind, does offer an opportunity for states around the nation to include school climate as one of those non-academic measures of success. And we're excited about that because we have the school climate rating. I'm not sure if you're familiar with that, ladies and gentlemen, but every school in Georgia, all 2,263 schools in Georgia receive a school climate rating on a scale of 1 to 5, 1 being poor and 5 being very good. What ESSA was intending to do was encourage states to do that. So we're already well on that way of doing that, and we released the first school climate ratings last year. The school climate ratings will be released probably in the next month for the 14-15 school year. And why is that important to this discussion? Because of many things. Number one, it puts school climate in the discussion. If you're going to be measuring school climate, then automatically it becomes part of the discussion in education. Number two, the way it was created, and I won't go into the details of it, it was created in such a way that a school can go into the metrics that make up the school climate and find out exactly why they have a 3, or why they have a 1, or why they have a 5. But we tell them too, and this is being encouraged by professional associations as well across the nation, it serves the purpose of identifying schools that need to work on school climate. The 1 or 2, there are things that you can identify that perhaps things like PBS can help, but they may need other things as well. But here's the other important part of it. Probably most of us can identify a school that at one time was achieving well academically, but now they're not. And you ask, well, what made the change? And the most common answer you get, which is erroneous, research shows, well, the demographics changed. That's an erroneous reason why the academic performance changed. What changed was the school climate. The expectations is what changed. So the value of the school climate rating is also on the top end of that. If you have a school climate rating of 4 or 5, Kim, that's fine, but if it starts going down, and you look up one year and it's a 3 when the year before it was a 4, but your academic outcomes are still the same. You say, well, we're okay because academic outcomes are the same. But I'm telling you, and we're telling schools, be mindful of that because that's the canary in the cave. When that school climate rating starts going down, guess what's going to follow that? The academic outcomes will then start going down. And I think all of that, I'm giving them more credit than they deserve, but USED, I think, is trying to get us to have that conversation.
Comment here.
Hi, yes. My name is Corey Sanchez-Smith. I am the Social Emotional Learning Coordinator for Atlanta Public Schools.
All right.
So we have a lot of great things happening that's in vain with what you're saying. I had a thought that really was kind of a parallel issue, I think, to the conversation around logistics and transportation and personnel, and that is the stigma associated with mental health in our communities and how even when you can identify a need, if the family is not ready to accept that there is an issue that maybe needs some more support, they still won't come. So I'm wondering what strategy or approach or conversation has started around changing our thoughts as people in homes around mental health and what that means for children and the adults.
Anybody else want to answer?
That was out of line.
Well, you make a great point, and I see the value of it starting with making sure all of us understand mental health. And that's a broad jump because we're finding with the youth mental health first aid and also the mental health first aid for adults that there are a lot of misconceptions about mental health. So it starts with us. And then I can foresee us having mental health first aid training for parents throughout the state of Georgia to get to your point. But and it doesn't mean we can't do both at the same time, but the awareness, there's training that's effective, mm-hmm. It's available, it really shows a change in attitude and therefore change in outcomes. We just have to make it more available on a broader scale. And I don't know if you've had the first aid mental health training, but it's very good training, and it's based on just about everything you just said.
And the only comment I would make is, and we see a few more questions, and I see my colleagues who are a lot more knowledgeable than I am about this, but for us, I know that it begins with understanding the perspective of the family or the parent first, and that if you focus on what they're trying to achieve and don't label it, you know, everybody wants their child to do and succeed. And if we start a conversation around your child succeeding or you succeeding, then it doesn't have to be about a label of mental health or not mental health. And I know back to that study I was talking about on the West Side, it wasn't a question to community about diagnosing what was going on from a DSM-4 perspective. It was asking community what is preventing your community from being successful. And people would identify the fact that people in their community are not happy, they're not feeling well, and we didn't have to label it, just provide a solution to that problem, that as people identify it and take the stigma off of it, then we can start a conversation in a very different way about solution versus cause.
That's a really good point, because we found that there's a real difference between labeling a behavior and describing a behavior, because we tend to characterize a behavior, which automatically puts a lot of people on the defensive instead of just describe the behavior. We ran into that on trying to deal with discipline issues. That's, if you tell a parent their child's involved in a gang, you've lost them. But if you describe the behavior, then they're with you on trying to do something about the behavior.
So we have bear,
That's probably
last question.
We'll take this question and this question, then we'll have to close up.
Hi, everyone. My name is Laura Porter. I'm with Families First. I just wanted to piggyback on you and Ms. Anderson. I think it's all about packaging as far as the mental health stigma. It's not what it is, it's not what you say, it's how you say it. So when it comes to, again, meeting the families where they are, it's not saying mental health, because that's what causes the stigma. When they see mental health, they automatically assume, oh, you want to be in my business, or you want me to say, oh, I'm depressed, or all of that. But when you come and ask them, how are you feeling? You know, how's your child doing? And they start opening up. That's what it's about, because that's what creates the stigma, is the wording, it's the package. Yeah, thank you.
One more question. That doesn't stop us from dialoguing after. But.
Hi, I'm Tammy Graham, a professor of political science and criminal justice at Atlanta Metropolitan State College. I'm an active member in my children's school. Question I have from a policy perspective. When we get to a point of funding, because this is an area where there is no rate of return on a spreadsheet, on account balance. There's nothing there for us to look at. How can we sustain it, not only from a conversational standpoint, but also understanding this proactive approach is not giving us a rate of return immediately in an instant gratification world. This is a rate of return in the long run.
Well, it is hard to measure prevention, and sometimes it's even hard to measure intervention. I think there has to be a mature discussion about managing expectations and using data that shows what you have and why you have it, and those elements that could change the trajectory. So I think the larger picture discussion, as you alluded to, is what we need to shift to. And that seems obvious, but frankly, that's not what we do. We're so project-oriented, we're so program-oriented, and I'd say even more project-oriented than anything else, that we really don't have the discussion that really helps, for example, legislators. You know, I made a comment at one of the study committees, Representative Jasperse, that I kind of feel sorry for the legislators, because they have one person after another saying, this is what you need to do. And some of them, sometimes they're connected, but most of the times they're not. So we're almost putting the legislators in a position to pick and choose without giving them the bigger, larger sustainability picture that you're suggesting.
So as Steve comes up to close us out, maybe we each might want to share a couple of parting words. And the one I like to say is back to the comment, picking on the comment earlier, and that is, you know, we often talk about it takes a village, okay, but we always forget that we're the village. And so, you know, and there are labels in this titles, but at the end of the day, before there was governors and before there were nonprofits and foundations, there was the village. So that's how I like to. Representative?
Oh, I just would just echo how I ended my conversation. You know, it's just that you've got to make sure you're telling your story to people like me who are not in social work, who are not in education, to make sure, because, you know, as my daughter says, when it's a lawyer, says, believe it or not, you're a decision maker. And, you know, and you are. And so, and you do, just like you mentioned, you get a lot of different information, and it's us to filter it and rely on people who we trust, that they give us accurate, fact-based information to make good decisions with. And I just want to just encourage you to make those personal connections with those in your communities.
Emily?
I'm gonna cheat, because I'm gonna pick up on your point that we are the village. I think if everyone here today thinks of one or two things that they heard that was new or was compelling, or that they could take with them into their personal life, whether it's your own child, you're a teacher at your kid's school, a colleague, someone you know who's working in this space who you might learn something from, but figure out a conversation that you can have with somebody about this, because I think that is what it will take before we're really going to break down that big, huge S word, which is stigma. It's enormous. I'll just share, a lot of people in my family have mental health issues. It's a very personal issue for me. I mean, hugely personal. And so that idea of stigma is very powerful. So the way that we all break that down is we talk about it. We talk about it with respect, and we listen to people who are suffering, and we understand how they want to talk about it. So I think we all just take one thing out of this room today and go plan some conversations. That's how we do it, and we still have to do all this policy stuff, but it doesn't happen without you know, public interest and motivation and political activism. And so it's the folks in this room that have that kind of power to change the conversation. So I just want to thank you all for coming.
And Gary, I don't know if you want to end with your story.
We don't have time for that. But
okay. Right.
It's a good story, though. You should ask him afterwards.
It's a good story.
Somebody will take you to lunch.
It's a good
but I will
story.
Say, I will say this. Do you remember the research that Stanley Milgram did many years ago, 6 degrees of separation? You remember that? He basically found that each person can influence 10 other people. On an average, some more, some less, but you can influence at least 10 other people. And Steve, there's over 200 people in here, so to your point, Kim, this is a call to action for over 2,000 people that can take the message that, and whatever message it was that you heard today that grabs your heart, take that message to somebody and let that be your mission for the day. Thank you, Steve.
Thank you, Kim.
Well, when we said we'd dedicate this critical issue forum to this critical issue, I think we hit that one right on the mark. It makes me think very much of a few of the things that came out of this are important. We always like to get to the so what, and Kim, thank you for facilitating the conversation to tease some of those out. More training for parents and staff in this field, bigger push from us, perhaps to the governor, perhaps through voices, but to have more collaboration among the agencies. I like the phrase, Gary, that you used from the judge, the quote from the judge, that your behavior can end up being your language. That was addressing little kids, but think about that for teenagers. Think about that for us. I would ask you just to take a minute before you rush out of here to your next meeting and think about what can and should be done to help Georgia in this space. And think about what you or your organization can do to help improve the mental and physical health of kids in Georgia. Another round of applause for our panel.